What's up, ladies and gentlemen? Joe Bonamassa here with another exciting episode of Live from Nerdville. Today, I am so honored to welcome my friend and yours, the Reverend Billy F. Gibbons. We talk about everything from Joe Hardy to guitars and how he got the Pearly Gates Les Paul to music and just all things Billy Gibbons. So check it out. It was nice running into you last night at Guthrie's gig.
Who would have thought, you know, it was a very tidy environment. It was quite nice.
He's such a good player. Such a good dude. I've gotten to know him a little bit over the last couple of years, and I've heard his name around town for years, but you know, I don't get out much.
Didn't you enjoy the accompaniment, the bass player, the keyboard, the percussion sounds, all made for a very nice platform? And of course, the intimacy of that room, what more could you ask for? It turned out to be cool.
Yeah, I tell you what, not only do I miss playing shows, as we all do, but I miss being able to see the crowd. I don't remember a time when I was able to do my own gig where I can actually see people in the audience, because you're kind of on a stage and you got the spotlight, and you know, it just kind of looks like you're looking into this cavernous, empty, you know, hall. But it's good to see people's reaction, you know.
Yeah, man. One of my favorite moments during the break, I don't know if you caught this, but Guthrie strolled over to the table with a video clip illustrating your waltz across the street without a case, holding a vintage Fender Nocaster. I loved it.
Yeah. I live across the street from this venue.
Yeah.
And Guthrie was like, hey, come sit in. I said, you know, I'm not even going to like bring a case. And he goes, okay. And I don't think he thought I was serious about it. And there I was. I was like, I'll take the 53 Esquire across the street. I'm not scared. Those things are made to last, you know?
Well, they're war clubs. They were designed to be beat on, thrashed with. And, it sure sounded good. I'll say that.
Thank you. You know, when I first met you back in the 90s with sadly, the late, great Joe Hardy, you were playing Esquires. You were playing Black Fender Esquires. And you had these snakes, snakes like put in the middle, like where the pick guard would be. And they were like the coolest looking guitars ever. And
yeah.
You know, yeah. They're so simple, but you still sounded like Billy Gibbons. Whatever you play, you sound like yourself.
Well, there's certain magic which you and I can join the many players that have found some real handiness in the utter simplicity of a Fender Esquire.
Right.
It comes down to a challenge. It becomes all in the hands.
Yeah. There's no rhythm position. There's no change of sound. It's just direct. You know, and they haven't have a spot on the switch where he goes directly to the jack, and you bypass the tone pot, and it's like it's just the pickup.
Yeah. Oh yeah. Yeah. They're really something to behold. I remember James Harmon. Unfortunately, he went to another planet recently. He passed away. But yeah. One afternoon, I was saying, "Gee," I said, "I was following some guys out of a show. We had just pulled off a show, and I overheard these two guys talking. And the one fella said, well, he said, I could probably do that if I had one of those fancy guitars." Right. And it was James. He said, well, if they're blaming you for your asset, which is now turned against you, he said, go get a Fender Esquire.
Right.
Show them that, you know, just take it back to square one.
Yeah. Yeah. And it makes you play, you know, it makes you really kind of just concentrate on the music and being a member of an ensemble, you know?
Yeah, man. Yeah, indeed.
What was your first guitar? I know you've been asked this a million times, but what was like, cause you know, you're a renowned collector and have some great guitars. What was the very first instrument you owned?
Believe it or not, as we speak of simplicity, I had the Gibson version of entry level. It was a Melody Maker, right. Single cutaway, single pickup. There right. again.
right.
It was a good way to start off. Connected to a simple Fender Champ.
Mm-hmm.
You teach your hands how to get around tones.
So you started on electric. I was the same way. I started on electric. I always wanted to be an electric guitar player. You know, you have a very famous line in our camp. We always use the Billy Gibbons line going, when somebody brings an acoustic guitar, we goes, oh man, that's kryptonite.
Yeah, man, it's like if you had a choice, sailboat or a power craft. Don't give me a blowboat.
Right. Like was ZZ Top, like, you know, back in like the early 90s when they were doing all those MTV unplugs, did they ever come to ZZ Top and say, hey, we'd like to do an MTV unplugged of the classic? I would imagine they did.
You know, when that invitation arrived, we thought that the nearest thing that would make sense would be the bridge between acoustic and electric. And of course, that would be the National Resonator guitar.
Right.
It's kind of the stepping stone between the two.
Right, right.
And they're loud and trashy. So I said, yeah, we may consider it.
Yeah. It's the thing about, I've known you for a long time, and I remember sitting there in France, and you were playing me all these songs, and you have so much music and knowledge of music and the history of not only blues, but the stuff that, you know, has come before us. You know, does it get overwhelming sometimes having that much music in your mind? You know, when it comes to writing a song or, you know, just going, I don't even know what I want to listen to today, if I want to listen to anything.
Well, yeah. What seems to be unfolding is a wealth of all sorts of music. I think we're surrounded right now with as much music, certainly more than ever before. And what's really crazy is all accessible.
Right.
And however, at the same time, I'm constantly amazed. I've got about a dozen records that never seem to be too far away from the turntable. I go right. back to the same right. thing. But what's really fascinating, let's take one of my favorites, of course, is the great work of Jimmy Reed.
Yeah.
And a lot of folks mistakenly say, oh yeah, that's that simple stuff. Underneath it all is a level of sophistication that's crazy. I've been listening to Jimmy Reed records forever, and it never ceases to amaze me that on any given day I can listen to it and I'm hearing things that I never thought was possible.
Right.
You hear something new.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's like, on a lot of those blues records, you know, a lot of people will say, it's just the blues. It'll be easy. And I go, oh, that's just the wrong thing to say. It's easy to play bad blues. It's very difficult to play it correctly, you know, with the right spaces.
Yeah, there's a lot of ways to play those, we call it those same three chords. Those right. same chords have a million angles.
Yeah, and how did you, when you started to go down that rabbit hole and take that journey with blues, you know, you even within the context of ZZ Top always played the right stuff at the right time, you know, and it's like how did you start identifying what the right stuff is? because I've been trying to do it for years and I can never figure it out. But you always had the it was always the subtle reference or just this little thing you would throw in that would, to me, make the song or make the solo. And it was you just go, that's something that's a deep knowledge. It's a deep well.
Would you tend to join me in pointing the finger at Keith Richards? He said, yeah, it's three chords. Let's just do it a different way.
Right, exactly. tell me, what was it like hanging with Hendrix? There's those great photos of you with Jimmy. I believe like a 50s Fender Strat, which I always thought was yours because Jimmy never played a 50s model with a maple neck. He played the later ones. And there's these great pictures of you with him and that old Strat.
On any given night, you could go through the backstage door. There was always a truck with two dozen brand new Strats,
right,
of which were sent over so that Jimmy could go through them and pick his favorite one.
Right.
My most enduring recollection was sharing at the end of the hotel rooms, the hallway, we'd always be relegated to the very last room. He had the left side and I had the right, but the doors were always open. And I recall watching a record player being hauled into his room, and he motioned, he said, hey, come on over. Lo and behold, he was listening to the Jeff Beck group. And he said, and he's pointing to the record and he says, how do you think Jeff Beck does that? I said, Jimmy, I bet Jeff Beck is pointing to one of your records going, how does this guy do that?
Right. when did you find that the Les Paul pretty much was the sound of early ZZ Top? I mean, like the ZZ Top's first album has a little picture of Pearly right in the center of it. I was like, that if that's not the coolest tribute to the legendary Pearly Gates, I don't know what it is. And when did you, like, because obviously you played Tellies, you played Broadcasters, Strats on ZZ Top records, but when you think of those early recordings, it's that big thick Les Paul sound.
Yeah. There's a constant recollection of the John Mayall Bluesbreaker record. They call it the Beano album.
Right.
Pictured on the front is the band. And of course, Clapton is reading a copy of the English comic book,
right,
the Beano. But if you turn the record over, that telltale photograph pretty much says it all. You can see Clapton, he's cradling a sunburst, and kind of out of focus, you see the little Marshall behind him.
Right.
That was the key. That seemed to be the combination. And of course, later on, I teamed up with Jeff Beck. The Moving Sidewalks jumped on board a tour where Jeff was actually, he too was playing a sunburst with a stack of 100 waters. And, you know, that was the eye opener.
Mm-hmm.
It still stands as a cornerstone today. I don't know too many people that don't really put two and two together in that fashion, but that was really the turning point.
Right. Do you remember what you paid for Pearly?
Oh yeah. I had been looking ever since discovering the Bluesbreakers. I kept asking her. I said, man, you know where we could find one of those guitars with the big fat pickups. We had no clue what they were even called.
Yeah.
And a buddy of mine said, hey man, he said, there's a cowboy outside of town. He's got a ranch outside of town. He played in a band, but I think he's got one of those guitars. He doesn't play anymore. Maybe you ought to go talk to him. Mm-hmm. And we had a girlfriend that had been invited to come out to California to try out for a part in a movie.
Right.
But she didn't have a way to get there. So we had an old Andy Feehan and I, we shared the keys to this 1939 Packard. It was huge. And she was this petite little thing. We said, Renee, hop behind the wheel and see if it'll get you to the West Coast, which it did.
Nice.
Not only did she get there, but she got the part. Well, she had no use for the car, so she sold it and she sent us the money. The day that that check arrived was the day that we went out and found this guitar laying under the bed in this nice old brown case. Voila. The guy said, well, there it is. I don't play it. I'm ready to get rid of it. What you got? I waved a check for $250.
That's great. I mean, do you look at the prices of like some of these guitars? I mean, like, because you're very responsible for these guitars being that valuable. You know what I mean? It's like, you would you ever think they were going to be like $300,000, $500,000, some of these things? I mean, obviously they're like Stradivariuses, but it's an electric guitar.
Yeah, it's a mystery. And our buddy George Gruen has made a point to illustrate the time when the solid body electric guitar became a production item.
Right.
They were cast aside as kind of the unwanted stepchild. The jazz box guitars were being treated gingerly and so much attention was given. These solid body things were rolling down with very little thought, given the fact they were under the impression, well, this is a passing fad. These things will never last. And of course, the opposite side of that coin was very quickly flipped upside down. And now they have turned out to be probably, you know, some of the top of the line. The good news is that when we say that they were kind of considered second class,
right?
They were genuinely well made.
Yeah,
and not only have they lasted, but the sound has become the beat on the street. You can't. It's hard to beat them.
Yeah, yeah, it is very hard to beat. Speaking of the beat on the street, I think one of the coolest thing videos I've ever seen. I believe it was you. You were in Stockholm, Sweden, or someplace in Scandinavia. You had a Strat, and you're ripping this killer blues on the street like you were a busker, and to watch people walk down the street, because you're very recognizable, okay? You know, there's it's very hard for you to go incognito, okay? And people were going, it can't be Billy Gibbons. And it was you.
Gilligan and I, she had dragged me down to a little shopping zone. And you're right, it was in we were in Helsinki.
Helsinki, right.
Sure enough, man. And we decided to make a walk back. We took some avenue, we took a left turn, and there a couple blocks away, we heard the sound of a guitar. And as we made the corner, there was a guy, had a little battery powered amp. And he, now he did make the connection. And as we approached, he kind of signaled, he said like, hey, you want to take over? And I threw it across the shoulder and he had a he must have had some type. He was playing a slow blues number.
Yeah,
and I kind of fell into it, and I kept on for a good 4 or 5 minutes, and not one single person even stopped.
That's great.
Yeah, it was great.
But what I was, you know, one of the things I did notice about that video, it was like a slow blues loop, and you're playing his, basically a stranger's guitar. But your tone was like dropping the needle on Blue Jean Blues. It's like, come on. You know, it's like, that was really, really killer. And I tried to busk one time for a DVD in New York City on the 72nd Street platform. Made no money, and I even seeded my own case. I put money in the case to try to encourage. Not a single person cared, and we were headlining the Beacon. You know,
yeah, sure enough, man. The one regret was leaving that. As I remember, it was kind of a seafoam green Stratocaster, but I left, and by the time I realized, gee whiz, maybe I should have made an offer to buy that thing from him, because it, as you point out, it had a sound, man. Yeah. It was, but we went back and gone, you know.
Oh, yeah.
Who knows?
Yeah, right.
Another one that got away.
Just before we wrap up, I love the tracks I've heard from the new album, Hardware. It sounds great. And I love the nod to Joe Hardy, who was the producer of my first album, and obviously you knew him, and we all loved him, but thanks for being here. It's an honor to know you, sir, as it's always been, you know.
Well, thank you for that. Our exchanges always go deep. Mm-hmm. The next time we cross paths, we'll take it deeper.
I will see you in New York City for the Love Rocks. I'm on that gig.
Oh yeah, yeah. We'll be crossing paths around the corner, and let's pick it up where we leave. Today's been great. We'll make it greater.
All right. Billy Gibbons, ladies and gentlemen, this has been Live from Nerdville. Thank you.